Hello friends, today we will discuss about electricity, magnetism and semiconductor. This is our second chapter, and in this chapter we are going to discuss about electric charge and conservation of electric charges and Coulomb's inverse law. So in previous lecture we have already discussed about the electric charge. So what is electric charge? For example, suppose that this is a glass rod and this is a woolen cloth. When we make a friction between this glass rod and this woolen cloth, so what will happen? This glass rod possesses a positive charge and this woolen cloth possesses a negative charge. Why this happened? Remember that when we discuss about the atomic structure, the atom has a nucleus which is a positively charged, and the electrons are revolving around the nucleus in a circular path, that is called as the shell or orbit. So actually each and every atom is electrically neutral. Why? Because the number of protons are exactly equal to the number of electrons. This is the fact. Suppose that this is an aluminium atom. So number of protons will be 13. Number of protons will be 13 and number of electrons will be also 13. So proton possesses a positive charge and electron possesses negative charge. This positive and this minus will vanish to each other and the resultant charge will be zero. That's why each and every atom is electrically neutral. Reason is that the nucleus possesses a positively charged protons and negatively charged electrons are outside the nucleus and they are revolving in a circular path. So this is the main reason. The number of protons are exactly equal to the number of electrons. That's why atom is electrically neutral. So what happened actually? Suppose that this is a glass rod. So glass rod is a bad conductor of electricity, and in this chapter we are going to discuss about why substances are good conductor or semiconductor or insulators. So reason is very simple. So conductors can be classified into three different classes. First, conductors can be classified into three different classes. And one more additional class is that is the superconductors. So conductors can be classified into three different classes. First is conductor. Second one is a semiconductor. And third one is a insulator. Insulator means bad conductor. So why material show the properties like conductivity, semiconductivity and insulator? Insulator is nothing but dielectric material. Dielectric is nothing but bad conductor, and bad conductor means insulator. So remember that suppose that this is an aluminium atom. So in first cell there will be a 2 electron, in second cell there will be a 8 electron, these 2 and this 8 is equal to 10 electrons, and remaining 3 electrons accommodate in a last cell. So this is the last cell, or it is also called as outermost cell. So in this cell there are 3 electrons, so these are free electrons. Remember that the conductivity of any material is depend upon the number of free electrons present in an outermost shell of an atom. So that's why these are the number of free electrons present. 3 free electrons are present in aluminium atom. That's why aluminium shows the good conductor. So for example, aluminium is there. All metals are good conductor of electricity because the number of free electrons present in their outermost shell only escape to mercury. Mercury means Hg. Hg means mercury, so which we used in a thermometer. So it is a metal, but it is a optional, it is a exceptional metal because it exists in a liquid form and shows the bad conductivity of electricity. So this is an exceptional material or exceptional metal. It do not shows the good conductivity of electricity. But all the metals are good conductor of electricity because the maximum electrons are present in the outermost shell, which are free electrons and causes the conductivity of electricity. In case of a semiconducting material, for example, silicon, germanium, arsenic, a moderate electrons are present in the outermost shell, so it shows the semiconductivity. And there is a lack of free electrons in the outermost shell of the insulating material. That's why they shows the bad conductivity and also called as the semiconductor. For example, glass, wool, mica, ebonite, wool. These are the examples of insulator. Now, let's see how this charge work and what is the law of conservation of energy. And how can we compare the conservation of electric charge? We know that the statement of a law of conservation of energy. The law of conservation of energy states that energy neither be created nor be destroyed, but one form of the energy can be converted into another form. In similar manner, I can write here the statement of electric charge. Electric charge cannot be, or electric charge neither be created nor be destroyed, but charges can be transferred from one body to another. This is the law of conservation of charges. So this, it means that charge always remain conserved. So next point is Coulomb's inverse law. Coulomb's inverse law. This law states that, I would like to write here the statement of this law. Coulomb inverse law state that when two charged particles attract or repel to each other the force of attraction or repulsion is directly proportional to the magnitude of the product of magnitude of charges and inversely proportional to the square of distance between them. So actually this statement is very descriptive, but when I draw a diagram here, you can easily understand this descriptive statement. For example, this is a particle A and this is the particle B. This is charge plus Q and this is charge plus Q2 and this is Q1. So remember that the distance between particle A and particle B is R. So what is the statement? According to the Coulomb's inverse law, and this law states that when two charged particles attract or repel, so question is arises that when they will attract to each other and when they will repel to each other. So this phenomenon is a very simple phenomenon. Suppose that this is a positive rod and this is a negative rod. Suppose that these are two color markers are here. Suppose that this is positive, this is negative, so they will attract to each other, but both have a same charges, they will repel to each other. So in case, suppose that here is a positive plus positive Q1 and here will be a negative Q1, so these two charges experience a force of attraction, and when there are similar charges, they will experience a force of repulsion. So how much that force is? So that force is directly proportional to, here P is directly proportional to the product of their charges. So Q1, this is the product of charges of particle A1, Q2 is the magnitude of charge B. So Q1 and Q2, this is the product of means when we multiply Q1 to Q2. So F is directly proportional to Q1, Q2. So this is called as equation number 1. And second statement is that the particles attract or repel to each other, the force of attraction or repulsion is directly proportional to the product of magnitude of charges and inversely proportional to. So this force is inversely proportional to square of distance between them. So what is the distance between two particles? R is the distance between. So it's square. So this is the inversely proportional to. This is the second statement or equation number second. So F means a force of attraction or repulsion. So the statement states that the force is directly proportional to the magnitude of the product of magnitude of charges and inversely proportional to the square of distance between them. When we combine both the equations, by after combining equation number 1 and 2, we get a new equation. F is directly proportional to the Q1, Q2 and inversely proportional to the R square. But remember that we have to remove this proportionality sign. So I can write here F is equal to K Q1 Q2 upon R square. So what is K? This K is a dielectric constant and it has a specific value. This K is equal to 8.854 into 10 raised to minus 12 Coulomb square per Newton meter square. So always remember this constant value of dielectric constant. But remember that here are two cases. In this equation, there are two cases. What will happen when this Q1 and Q2 has a similar charges? Either they may be a negative charge or either they may be a positive charge. So force of repulsion will be takes place. But where the force of repulsion will be takes place, this F means this force has a positive sign. And when they shows a dissimilar charges, so force of attraction will be here, they shows a negative sign for the force. So that's all about the today's lecture. Thank you.